Here's the job of every Christian: to follow Jesus, I got to love him with all of my heart, my mind, my soul, and my strength. To love him with my mind, I got to be wise. I got to know what's going on. I got to think right about him. Philosophy not grounded in him, not good. Agreed? Say amen, and if you don't agree, that's all right. I'm going to try to get you to agree. Now, I just want you to understand the two philosophies and get real specific with you, because it can sound, you know, intellectual and all those things. By the way, the church we have to be people who use our minds, because the battle is a battle of our minds. I talked about that 6 weeks ago when I introduced this whole thing. If you weren't here, write on a card and we'll send you a link to that teaching that goes more into the background. Let's start up here with just basic core things. Here's what your children are being taught in the school system and in every place, unless Jesus Christ reigns or there's another philosophy, but this is what they're currently being taught. My identity is based on my gender, race, and sexual orientation. Who am I? Well, personally, I'm a white man. So I'm a white man. And that could be really bad. Or maybe you are, Carol's with us, she's an African-American woman. Other brothers and sisters who have struggled with homosexual urges, is that your primary identity? Your primary identity is that you're oriented homosexually? Well, the Bible doesn't teach that. No. The Bible says my identity is based on being in Christ. What does that mean? Here's who I am. I'm redeemed by Jesus Christ. I am a saint by Jesus Christ. I have been transformed. I'm in Christ with all the benefits, eternal destiny based on Christ. And everybody who's in Christ with us, there is no other. The Bible literally says there's no Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, barbarian, Scythian. There is no race. There is no sexual orientation. There is no age. None of those things. We're in Christ. And everybody who's in Christ, we're all equally brothers and sisters of one another. And any other category is secondary to being in Christ. Key stuff. Number two, truth is based on the intersection of my identity. I hate to say this, but I'm going to say it. So there was a young lady baptized in this church, and she went off to college and came back woke, and she still claimed to be a Christian, but she was saying how terrible it is that Tennessee restricted abortions, and she posted this funny thing like, hey, if you want to ride to another state, come with me and I'll bring lunch and you can get an abortion. I'm like, I can't believe she said that, and it like ticked me off. So I'm like, hey, that doesn't sound like what the Bible would say. And then all of her friends attacked me from the same, you know, they had the same teaching. So I'm a white man, I'm old white man, and I'm obviously a misogynist, and I don't have a uterus. And so that's what they all told me. And I said, actually, I think the one who made us all, who made uteruses, what he thinks matters more than anybody else. Do you understand what we're talking about here? That it is not the inner truth can be seen and understood by everyone. The traditional family should be rejected. The traditional in the Bible, the traditional family is ideal. We're going to talk more about this, but just keep your antenna up for attacks on the traditional family. Trying to normalize non-marriage, trying to normalize polymory. Polymory is when you're married to two people, which Will Smith's daughter has been public about. That's what she wants. Those become the norm, because this theory is driving it. Women must be freed from traditional manhood because it's misogynist, and it's actually what the Bible teaches about manhood is toxic masculinity, according to this theory. Whereas God says, no, it's the best for men. God, I want to get Carol up here. What God teaches is the best for men, and it's the best for women. Sexual liberation involves consenting people in any sexual behavior, including LGBTQ. Anything that restricts people, that's bad. Consenting adults, and in some cases even with children, consenting, that's okay. The Bible says sex is only for a marriage between a man and a woman. Any marriage form is good. Again, we talked about polymory, LGBTQ. Marriage is a covenant between one man and one woman. Authority is systemically oppressive. The whole system of critical theory is based on Marxism, neo-Marxism, and the philosophy says the goal in life is to throw off oppression. There are only two categories of people, the oppressed and the oppressors. So authority, the Bible teaches, in government, in the church, and in the home is God-given and good. To be done in the way of Jesus, but good. And lastly, overthrowing any system upheld by a dominant group is inherently valuable. So everything is about throwing off traditional ways. Now, I want to just say this, and Carol, if you'd please be coming up, and if we could have the stools, please. I just want to say this as Carol comes up. We tend to think that tolerance is good enough. So if I'm working in a company, I have friends worked at oil companies, and you know, they love all people. They're not making a deal of how they view sexual orientation. The practicing, it's the practice. But they live in a, they're in a company, and if they won't go to the gay pride parade, they're written up. If you say what you believe about certain things, you'll be canceled and fired. It's a new world. Here's the really heartbreaking thing. The number of kids who say they can't believe in the Bible because the Bible teaches racism. They can't believe in the Bible because of what the Bible says about homosexuality. They can't believe in the Bible because the Bible teaches misogyny. And they can't believe in the Bible. And all these people adopting this new philosophy, it's incongruent with the Bible. And then it's leading to this cultural disruption. So, friends, would you please welcome Carol Swain?
Hi. Thank you.
So, Carol Swain, most of you at this church know about Renew Network. She's a writer. She's actually working on a book right now, if she can ever get time for us. And she's going to be speaking with us. She's already done some of that. She has been a tenured professor at Princeton University and then Vanderbilt. And she has been at the forefront of seeing what's going on in our culture and how it's influencing so many people. And she's been speaking out about it. But before we get to that, Carol, would you just give a short, about 4 to 5 minute biography on yourself for people?
First of all, good morning, and thank you for being here today and for joining us online. And my story is that I came from a very untraditional background for someone who has reached the point where I am in life. I was one of 12 children born and raised in rural poverty in southwestern Virginia. We lived in a two-room shack for part of my life, and it was later expanded to a four-room shack, and we had no indoor plumbing. During the winter, when it snowed heavily, we stayed home from school until the snow melted. One winter, we missed 80 of 180 days. And so my school attendance as a child was very sporadic. I married at 16, had my first child at 17. By the time I was 20, I had 3 small children. I ended up meeting a couple of people that changed my life. One was a medical doctor, and at that time I was going through a period of suicidal gestures where I would take bottles of pills and instigate my own rescue. And, you know, so I wasn't really trying to die. In fact, I remember telling a doctor that if I wanted to kill myself, I was smart enough to know how to do it because I couldn't, I was embarrassed by so many failures. And I went to a community college, and I got the first of 5 degrees. And people came into my life, and they steered me into academia. So I have a degree in business, 1 in criminal justice, 2 in political science, and 1 in law from Yale that I got after I had taught at Princeton for about 10 years and had been a tenured professor. I had earned tenure there. And I came to Christ late in life. And when I think about it, my journey was a journey that after I earned my early tenure at Princeton, instead of 7 years, I did it, went up in the third year, got it in the fourth year, I became very disillusioned. I went on this journey that took me through New Age and Eastern religions, and I ended up just having a dramatic conversion experience. Vanderbilt reached out to me in 1998. I accepted a job from them. I did not come right away. I negotiated a sabbatical up front. I'm a good negotiator.
yes, you are.
And I came to Nashville in 2000, but I came as a born-again, on-fire-for-the-Lord Christian, even thinking that the Lord was going to move me out of academia and that I would be in the ministry. Well, 18 years later, circumstances sort of moved me out of academia, and here I am before you, actually doing ministry in a way that I got a glimpse of when I got saved, but I didn't know it would take 18 years in academia for it to come about.
Oh, that's great. Well, in the first service, I kind of asked you about your experience with racism growing up, and I made a comment that I'm going to make, and you schooled me, so you can do that again. But I just want to say this, because anytime I've had this conversation, it always comes up, and I just, when we talk about critical theory and critical race theory, we are not trying to diminish the reality for many people of the pain they've experienced of mistreatment because of racism. Racism is wrong. It's a sin. It can work both ways, as Carol will tell us. But I just want you to know that's our heart as a church. We care, and don't take any of this as diminishing those instances that happen. Now, this is where you slapped me down last time, so go ahead.
I had to react to Pastor Bobby's statement in the last service because it sounded too much like one of those university trigger warnings where professors are supposed to come in front of their classrooms and apologize for talking about whatever they're teaching about that day. And so I thought that maybe a pastor in a church of mostly adults wouldn't need to give a trigger warning because you all chose to be here. You knew we were talking about race, and I believe you can handle it.
You can tell Carol doesn't preach every week. I think we can too. So, Carol, talk to us about, and by the way, we're going to take our time on this. I just want to say that I don't want the clock to be a thing right now. And like if we go long and you need to leave, that's okay. But my concern is that we actually don't take the opportunity that God's given us with somebody like Carol, and we really let you share with us and help us to understand this. So talk to us about critical theory, why you're concerned about it. Let's just start there. Why are you concerned about all this?
Well, I think that what you really want to ask me about instead of that is that the pastor wants me to talk about my experiences with racism because I'm black, and so my whole life, you know, is affected by racism, right? I mean, isn't that the story? Isn't that what I'm supposed to say? And I can tell you that I was born in 1954. That was the year of the Brown versus Board of Education school decision from the Supreme Court that desegregated schools in all deliberate speed, which meant it was the late 1960s when schools integrated in my part of Virginia. And so my experience with racism is I remember segregation and going to segregated schools, but I also remembered everything opening up for me and this world of possibilities. And even though, you know, I had dropped out of school, all of these things were happening for blacks. And I would say that to the extent, you know, I'm a black person, is that I personally have been advantaged probably even more than I've been disadvantaged because of my race. And, you know, maybe you can say it was because I was bright. I mean, I certainly, you know, went through poverty. I didn't have those advantages of growing up in a middle-class family. But I can tell you that there were so many people that offered a helping hand, that mentored me and steered me into academia. And with one exception, they were all white. And many of them were white men. And so I cannot say that my experience has been all negative. My mentors, the people that helped me and encouraged me, and I give my mother some credit here. My mother was kind of indifferent about some things. Like when I was going to school and I met an A, she didn't jump up and down. She acted as if that was normal. And so I never felt that I was handicapped because I was black, I'm female, you know, I'm a woman, I got these kids. I never felt that I was a victim. And the mentors I had, and many of them were white, most of them were white, they never made me feel that I was handicapped. And so I believed I could do anything. And I had role models. They did not look like me.
That's good.
Oh, and now you want to talk about critical theory?
That'd be good.
Okay. When I went to college, I went, you know, as an older person, not too much older than everyone is. I was probably in my mid-20s when I started the four-year college. But a lot of people were interested in Marxism. And then later when I was at Princeton, everyone was into critical theory and deconstructionism and all of that stuff. I had no interest in it. You know, it was like, okay, I'm not interested in that. I'm just interested in being a congressional scholar. And I was not paying enough attention to what was taking place. And everything in colleges, critical theory was everything. I did not realize how it would impact my life and our lives today. And so for myself, when I started getting myself steeped in critical theory, it was about 10 years ago when I realized that it had taken over our society in ways that I never imagined. And critical theory is about deconstructing the traditional institutions that we hold dear, marriage, the family, the church, the government, taking it apart and replacing it with something else. And the critical theory, pretty much what we see taking place today on the streets. A lot of it is around critical race theory, but there's, you know, critical gender theory that you can throw critical into anything that you want to destroy. But what I saw was at the universities that the critical theorists, and I would say that a lot of the people who were the radicals of the 1960s, those radicals were mentored and instructed by people like Saul Alinsky, who wrote the book Rules for Radicals. And even though that book in the foreword is dedicated to Lucifer, I still think that people need to read it. They need to read it to understand how the left thinks, because he's all about redistribution from the haves to the have-nots. And so he really wants to create this society that's fair. And the critical theorists, the Marxists, they have a utopian vision of restructuring our society to make everyone equal, to make everything fair, but it is a godless theology, like Karl Marx called religion the opium of the masses. And his followers that came after him, they were very much interested in changing the culture from within. And to change the culture, they had to move people away from the Judeo-Christian foundations, from everything that came out of Western civilization. And they realized that the way to do that was to infiltrate organizations, to use deception and manipulation. And so you see, the radicals of the 1960s are now your college presidents. They're now your deans. They're the people that are changing our society. They've gone into our institutions like government, and they went into the churches a long time ago. Saul Alinsky targeted the Catholic Church first. And so he went into the Catholic Church, and so a lot of the left-wing activism within Catholicism started with him. And so that is a little bit about critical theory, but critical theory comes out of Marxism, and it's very much about overthrowing our society. And when you see groups like Antifa and Black Lives Matter, these are Marxist groups, and they were very clever about how they name things. And it's almost like whatever they name things in a way that's very deceptive. Let me say that. And you think about even the slogan, Black Lives Matter, that's a truth statement. Black lives do matter. All lives matter. But if you say all lives matter, that you're told that's hate speech. But black lives is a subset of all lives. And so you can't disagree that black lives matter. That's the name of an organization. And so if you subscribe to that organization, you're supporting an organization that's trying to overthrow your way of life. And it's not an organization that really supports or represents black people. And there was a Gallup poll survey that was taken between June 23rd and maybe the 1st of August. And so this was polling black people all across the country. And something like 81% wanted more police presence in their communities. They're not on board with defunding the police. And black people have more interactions with police than any other group because there's more crime in those neighborhoods. The last thing they want is defunding the police. But you have, you know, these Marxists pretty much pushing an agenda that has us at each other's throat. A lot of white people feel that black people hate them and vice versa. And that's a lie. And it's a lie that's being perpetrated through the media because they're on board with this.
Yeah, thank you. So, for example, let me just point something out we talked about in the first service. It is true that we need to make sure we're expressing concern for black lives and the experiences people have. But what's happening right now, Amazon.com, which I think is the world's largest or America's largest corporation, is funneling billions and all these organizations into Black Lives Matter. Now, if this is offending you, use that offense to go check out their website and see what Black Lives Matter holds to. It was started by Marxists. It advocates the overthrow of the family, the encouragement of LGBTQ lifestyles, and the disruption and the defunding of the police. So that is not consistent in any way with the values of Jesus. And yet you see the National Basketball Association, the NHL, Major League Baseball, they're all promoting, a lot of them unwittingly because they don't know what's going on, they're promoting this organization and funding it with billions, with a B, so that it can, its message and influence can spread. Carol?
Well, this other thing that I really think is important is that when I went through school and even people before me, we wanted an equal opportunity. You know, I just wanted to show them what I could do. I mean, I did not want a special treatment in the classroom. I did not want them to lower the standards for me. And you think about the generations of young people now, the ones on college campuses, they've never had it better. They come from affluent families. And you see Black Lives Matter at Rutgers University, they negotiated a different standard for black people that they don't have to learn standard English. You see, even Belmont University is totally on board now with Black Lives Matter agenda when it comes to every department. Faculty, whether or not they get promoted will be based on how they treat minority students. And students can always find something to complain about. And you know, for those of you who are young, I hate to say in my day, you know, people didn't care about your complaints. And you could complain all you wanted. You know, you had to meet the standard. And if you had a teacher that didn't like you, you had to figure out a way to navigate around that teacher. What they're doing now is crippling black students and the value of their degrees. They're diminishing the value of the degree of every black person. So if people from my generation and generations before mine went to college, and black people didn't just start going to college right after affirmative action. If you go back to the 1800s, there were always colleges and universities, many of them in the Northeast, that never discriminated against blacks. They had black alumni. W.E.B. Du Bois went to Harvard University, graduated from Harvard University, and many other blacks have gone to elite institutions before affirmative action. And what we have now is not affirmative action and diversity and inclusion. We have this whole different layer of people and deans and institutional structure called diversity and inclusion. And these people are pushing cultural Marxism. And this is something that will destroy our society. It is destroying our society, and instead of creating opportunities for minorities, it's decreasing opportunities, and it really is unequal. And it's based on the idea of critical theory believes that racism is permanent. And if it's permanent, there's nothing you can do about it, so we just might as well call it a day. Why are we talking about this? There's nothing we can do about it if it's permanent. That's what they argue, that it's permanent, that white people have a property interest in their whiteness. Every white person, even that poor kid in Appalachia that's J.D. Vance's relatives and maybe no one ever finished beyond the third grade in school, they are advantaged just because they have white skin. It says that for white people, the only thing they can do to make themselves right is to divest themselves of their whiteness. And how do you divest yourself of your whiteness? Well, pretty soon they're going to tell you through reparations that that's one way. But the other thing is, it's not enough for you to say, I'm not racist, and to truly not be racist. You have to be anti-racist or anti-LGBT or anti-male, and that means that you have to go out there and you have to fight, and they'll tell you what to say and do to make yourself right, but you can never be right. Because whiteness is permanent, it's property, you're going to be white all of your life, you can never be good enough.
And it also, let's talk about this for a second, because this will help people to see how it ties into the persecution. Some people were saying jokes, yeah, being a Christian is going to tie into persecution. Let me just talk about some ways. So, for example, if you've talked about how you've got to do anti-racist work, it's not enough to just be, I'm not anti-racist. You got to demonstrate it. And the way a lot of people are doing it is through the organization Black Lives Matter. But let's talk about...
And it's called virtue signaling. So when your corporation, you know, uses the hashtag or they give money, then that they are signaling their virtues.
So if you're somebody who believes that by following Jesus, we have to help each other to live according to biblical sexual standards, and that the LGBTQ lifestyles are not consistent with God's word, tell us how is it enough to just say, hey, I love all people? Or do you have to also, how do you have to do the work of facilitating and promoting the LGBTQ lifestyle?
I mean, the terrible thing is that for our young people, that they are being put in situations where if they don't join in, that signals that you're not one of us, you're not sufficiently woke, you're fair game for persecution. And that is, you make yourself a target if you decide that you're going to work in your office and you're not going to go to the gay parade or whatever is taking place. And it's a very dangerous time in America. And they talk about canceling people, you know, making it as if you don't exist. And they dehumanize people that are Christian and a conservative, a black conservative. Like, as a black conservative who doesn't share a particular set of views, then it's like, I don't exist. I'm not relevant. In the words, well, I can't say, but in the words of some politician that will remain nameless, you ain't black.
Yeah. Let's talk about gender, okay? Because there's a subtle thing going on that's the foundation of it is critical theory that somehow men are not good, and that masculinity is toxic. It has to be overthrown. Talk to us about that.
Well, I mean, I can't add much to what you've said. If you are a man, you are toxic, and you need to get in touch with your feminine side.
And so there's the promotion of, and in some cases it becomes a form of reverse misogyny, where if you're a man, you're disadvantaged and you're put down. I'm just going to say this, and this is the preacher. I could get really passionate about this, but I'm going to hold back. We are wounding young men. They don't know what it is to be a man, distinct from a woman. And God made manhood to be a beautiful thing, following Jesus, being bold and courageous, laying our lives down for our wives and families, being noble, strong, and good. And if we cannot teach men to be men, the world is going to undermine us all the way. And so we're floundering, not knowing what is it to be a man, what is it to be a woman. We got to stand for Jesus' truth, because Jesus' truth is the better way.
And I can tell you that I can feel the heaviness over this room, and the subject is so heavy, but it doesn't have to be that way. And Pastor Bobby talked about our identity is supposed to be in Christ. And if we have identity in Christ, it transcends, you know, race, gender, and ethnicity. And the people of God should be leading the way. We don't need the secular world to teach us about race relations and how to get along with one another. And if we want to argue that slavery was a sin, it was a sin in the same way that Joseph's brothers selling him into slavery, that was a sin. But God used that for good. And when you think about the slavery of blacks in America are better off than blacks anywhere else in the world. And they have the resources that they can help people that are impoverished in other nations. They are well positioned. They do have power. And that is the good that came out of slavery. And if you look at someone like myself, I would not exist had it not been for the fact that my ancestors came here under the circumstances. And I have, you know, Caucasian blood, and I haven't done any of those ancestry.coms, don't plan to do it, but I know that in my bloodline, you know, there are all sorts of, you know, different, there's no telling what would turn up, but it's okay. And everything that I have experienced, which includes considerable persecution, it helped make me who I am today. And I'm able to stand before you and talk. And one of the things I don't think I mentioned in this service is that I used to be painfully shy. I used to be so shy that when people asked me my name, I would forget. I'd freeze. And everything had to be written out. And I was still a professor. I had to write out everything. But when I had my Christian conversion experience and I met Christ, he removed my fear of public speaking, because he impressed on my mind that he had given me a message bigger than me. And as long as I focused on the message, I could speak, because I only had to please one person. And that's why I can be so bold. And people will also say that I might be in danger because I'm so outspoken. And the way I see it, we have one life to live, and we're all going to die unless, you know, Jesus comes, and those that believe we're going to be raptured out of here, you know, before persecution.
We don't believe that.
unless all of those things happen, we're going to die. And why not die for the kingdom? Why not die for the kingdom? And I think that those of us who compromise to get along, that we're really selling ourselves short. And, you know, if you lose because you stand for your values, God is able to give you so much more. And for myself, 2017, I took early retirement from Vanderbilt. I left the academy. I left the classroom. God has given me a much bigger classroom than I had being at one university. I'm able to reach far more people than I would have reached in one classroom. And so whatever seems bad at the time, God can use it to position you where you need to be. And that persecution you may be getting on your job, it could be God trying to move you where he wants you to be, and it may not be on that job where you're devalued.
That's good. That's really good. There is so much more that I would like to talk to you about. I do want to just come back to what Carol was saying, though. This is an opportunity for us to shine brightly, that we uphold the ways of Jesus. We're disciples of Jesus.
Amen.
This is the way of Jesus. And as disciples of Jesus, we have the better way. You've got to believe that it is the better way. It can't be just me saying it is. I'm telling you, it is the better way. It's built around God's truth, God's revelation. It's much better for men and women. It's much more better for blacks and whites and Hispanics and Indians. It's the better way of God are the ways of Jesus for us, and may we be faithful and believe that and stand for that and be convicted about it. Carol, one of the things I've noticed about you is that you're pretty vocal about this, and I commend you for that. I just want to say, maybe by way of encouragement to all of us, you know, in the postmodern world in which we live, where many of the Christians who went before us overstated truths, like they overstated the Bible says you can't have a drink, or the Bible teaches this specific thing, don't use instruments in worship, or they, you know, they overstated things. So what's happened to Christians now is we're kind of afraid that we're going to look like we're like these bigoted, overstating people. And so to not come across that way, we're losing our conviction to say, no, this is what God's word says, and I believe it, and it's the best for you. Why don't you join me? And that's what you do. And I just want to give you a chance to encourage people to really be bold and courageous so that we can be that light in the darkness.
Well, first of all, I'd say that, you know, we're losing our churches, but we're also losing our nation, and it's because not enough people have courage. And I believe that at this point in history that people have to be bold enough to speak up. And in the case of white people in particular, there is a racism that's taking place. And if you've gone through college, you've heard this many, many times, that black people and people of color can't be racist because you have to have power to be racist, and they don't have power. And that doesn't make any sense. It never made sense to me, but it certainly doesn't make sense when you've had a black president that was elected two terms, you've had two black attorney generals, you have people of color in positions of power throughout our society, and there's something very evil about shaming children and telling them, you know, that because of their ancestors, that they're responsible for all the evils in the world, and that if you happen to be raised in a two-parent family that's normal, that makes you privileged, and that's bad. And so I see a shaming taking place of our children, and I think it's important for all of us to reclaim our voice. We cannot be silent, and we cannot fear about what people are going to call us. And so this is the moment for people to stand up, fight for your faith, fight for your churches, and fight for your nation, because this nation was founded on Judeo-Christian values and principles. Liberty and freedom, that's important, as well as authority. And so I would encourage people, don't be ashamed of the family that God placed you in, whether that family was dysfunctional or you know, very traditional, you had the perfect life. That's a blessing that you were born with a family that loved you and treated you well. That's not a point of shame. And so you need to stand up for your children. If you're white, you're protected by the Civil Rights Act of 1964, as well as the Equal Protection Clause of the Constitution. And when it comes to people of black people, people of color, I'm going to say that because that's what people, you know what I'm talking about. When it comes to people of color, this, if you're a Christian, there's a place for forgiveness. The Bible tells us, forgetting those things that lie behind, we press forward. And it does not make sense to dwell in the past and consider yourself a victim, because we are not victims. In Christ, we're all victorious.
That's right.
And so the best thing you can do is help people be victorious. Mm-mm. We show love, but we don't have to show our love by you know, getting down into the mud with other people and agreeing with them when we know they're wrong. And I think one of the worst things that's taking place now is that too many of us are trying to keep the peace by agreeing with people that we know are wrong. We need to stand up, and we need to hold our churches, we need to hold our institutions, we need to hold our professional organizations accountable. And that will take some risk, but there are more of us than there are of them. There are some people out there waiting for you to stand up, and when you stand up, they will join you. All they want is one person to stand up. So I challenge you all to be that one person who stands up. People will rally behind you. So that's all I got to say about that.
Isn't that great? Thank you. Now, I want to pray with you.
All right.
I want to pray with Carol. I'd like you to reach out your hands to her, and then I would like us all to have communion together, because we want to come back to the thing that keeps us all centered, and that's centered in Jesus. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for opening the door that I could become one of Carol's friends, and that she could come to this church and speak out. She told me, Lord, that she felt like maybe she was called to be a martyr by standing up for these things. We just pray for her. We pray that you give her wisdom. And God, we pray for all of us, everyone here and everyone watching, that we would be courageous, that we would remind one another the ways of Jesus are the best way. The way of hope is with Jesus, because one day he's coming back and he's going to give us all of our heart's desires in the new heaven and new earth. So between now and then, may we all, each of us, Carol, me, all of us, may we all be found faithful to the Lord and King of the universe, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you.